Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. God describes false prophets as wolves and sheep's clothing. Now, clearly, if we would just stop and take a look at that, it's not just a catchy phrase. It's a wolf is a dangerous animal. A sheep, not so much so. And since the wolf is going to present itself in sheep's clothing, it's not going to be something that you may easily recognize. But as he said, wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. Now, I'm not talking about salvation here. What I'm talking about is those that would come and present supposed biblical truths that don't necessarily line up, at least dispensationally, with the Word of God. And that's what we've got to watch out for. I think most people kind of understand, they may not all believe it, but most people kind of understand that the biblical truth of salvation is not of us. It's not of works. Jesus Christ died in our place. He paid our sin debt in full, and we need to, by faith, trust Him, and He gives us everlasting life. But beyond that, I think there are a lot of people that can be easily led in all kinds of directions. And once you go down that path, maybe you might be inclined to start doubting the biblical truth of salvation by grace through faith. In other words, these individuals, these wolves in sheep's clothing, appear to be something that they're not. Worse yet, they appear to be warm, white, soft, cuddly, something good, when in fact, they're just the opposite. They're wicked, they're dangerous. A ravening wolf is one that would take something by force, if it could, to prowl for food, to look, to devour, to feed greedily. They don't care about anyone except themselves, satisfying their own appetite, their own lusts, their own desires. Well, since they're disguised rather well, we're going to have to look for their markings, their tell, if you will. And they are experts at deception. Paul's told the Corinthians, a rather carnal, messed up group, who he had to warn about this because, well, and we need to be aware of this as well. But he said to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 11, in verse 13 to 15, he says, "For such are false prophets, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ." Now, the apostles of Christ, not the 12 originals, but an apostle is a sent one. And so they're going to present themselves as individuals who are sent from God to enlighten people, when in fact they have another agenda. Verse 14 says, "And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." I preach a message this morning on angels of light. He went to say in verse 15, therefore, because this crowd exists and we're supposed to be aware, we're not ignorant, the Bible said, about the devil and his crowd. We're not ignorant of his devices, or at least we shouldn't be. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Angels of light. Bah, humbug. You know what Jesus said? He said, evil men shall wax worse and worse. The Bible also said, be not deceived. And yet, humanly speaking, in the world, the cybersecurity out there, and really, that's kind of a, isn't that what I'm kind of expected to do? I'm like the cybersecurity for the church, for this church. I'm supposed to be watching out and making sure you don't get had. And so it's my responsibility to make sure that I preach the word. And I make sure that I rightly divide the word so that you won't be taken in by some other goofball out there, because they're out there. And that's the point that he's making here in the material world. He's saying the fraud is on the rise. And you know what's happening in Bible believing? Well, in Christendom. The real Bible-believing churches are beginning to diminish, and all the other goofy entertainment centers are growing by leaps and bounds. That's going on, and people are becoming less and less aware of it. They're signing up for it. Do you think the same thing is happening in the spiritual realm? Yeah, the devil knows he's got a short time, and time's waning, and he doesn't want people. I know the world somehow thinks that we're getting better and better and more people are being saved and the world's going to have a great revival and all that. No, it's not. The opposite is true. More and more people are falling prey to angels of light. Like I said, if this behavior is going on and increasing in the private sector, doesn't it seem to make sense that it's going to happen in the spiritual realm as well? Of course it is. We expect that there will be individuals out there watching out. Hey, it never happened before, but I love it today. I love the fact that our banking system monitors our spending. They know, I don't know, Frank, you'll be troubled by this, but they know if all of us, we have to tell our bank before we just went to Florida. We had to tell our bank that we were going to Florida. Lest you get to Florida and all of a sudden try to use a card and it shuts it off. Because they realize, wait a minute, Gary doesn't live in Florida. He shouldn't be spending money here. And they shut it down. And then you have to go in order to get it turned back on. Well, if you're 1,500 miles away, you can't really do that. Yeah. So I like it when all of a sudden they detect fraud going on and do something about it. Well, with that happening, there's people, organizations and all, fraud alerts. They have commercials for, I mean, they probably want you to spend a lot of money in order to have somebody monitoring your whole system and all of that. I don't know if that's necessarily something that needs to be done, but nonetheless, isn't the same true with the spiritual? I'll answer that. Yes, it is. In 1 John 4, in verse 1, John writes, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. Why? Because many false prophets are going out into the world. That warning began to occur 2,000 years ago when it was written. Do you think it's going to increase as time goes on? I had one daffy woman one time tell me that the reason that she goes and visits all the churches around is because of what the Bible says. I said, the Bible? I know that God has a strong emphasis on the local church, but I missed that verse. And she gave me this one right here. Try the spirits. And to her, that meant, you know, go around and try them out. That's what I'm talking about this morning. Angels of light. Someone would come along and tell you stuff like that. If it happens in the private or the corporate world, don't you think it's possible, at least possible in the religious? Have you ever been had in any way, shape, or form? Have you ever been snookered? How did it make you feel? You felt rather foolish, right? You think to yourself, I should have known better. Why didn't I see this coming? I thought it sounded fishy. The reason I'm saying this is because those kinds of fraudulent behaviors increase at this time of year. Because people are all happy and gay and they're buying and selling and having a good time and all that stuff. When do you think the devil might want to do his dastardly work? Probably at the same time. He knows that people are more inclined at this time to open up to things, God things, Bible things. It's a door, it's a way that he can get a foothold into the door of your life and lead you astray. Look at those noble Bereans in Acts 17. It says in verse 11 and 12, these were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They weren't of nobility, but they had a greater character. They recognized some things. They weren't taken by some smooth talker. It says, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Therefore, I love the way God always explains things. He gives you some facts and then he says, wherefore or therefore. In other words, then he says, because of that, this is what you need to do. This is what you need to be aware of. Therefore, many of them believed, also of honorable women, which were Greeks, and of men, not a few. You know, when all of a sudden you take what God said and you look at it for yourself in black and white, you'll be convinced. You'll realize, wait a minute, this is true. But if all you do is listen to the next wind of doctrine that gets blown around, you'll be swept all over the planet. Was it P.T. Barnum that said there's a sucker born every minute? Well, and he's talking about in the world. Well, I think God would say amen to that. I'll tell you, we're living in a dangerous time. The health, wealth, and prosperity gospel is still alive and well. And you know, any one of us could look up online to see the lifestyles and the multi-millions of dollars that these characters actually have. And that doesn't register. You know what? They prey off of our own carnality. It's all, as they've said for a long time, a pyramid scheme. The only people that are being successful here are the people at the top. I wouldn't have the nerve to do it because I figured somebody is probably going to be smart enough to figure me out. But can you imagine if I stood up here and say, now, I had a revelation from God this week, and he told me to tell the people that if they want to be blessed at this Christmas season, that they need to give me lots of money and other valuables. And when they plant that seed of faith and showing it to me, then that will, it's called trickle down. See, once I my barn is full, maybe some of it will trickle down to you. Are you serious? I couldn't bring myself with a straight face to say it. And yet, People do that all the time, and they jump on their own private jet and fly off to the next bunch of goofballs. As I said, the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel is still alive and well, and it preys on the lusts of flesh, our own stinking carnality, materialistic desires. How do they do it? Let me give you some reasons. Number one, they exalt themselves. They exalt themselves. In Acts 5 and verse 36, "For before these days rose up Thutis, boasting himself to be somebody, to whom a number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who was slain, and all as many as obeyed him were scattered and brought to naught." I'm not surprised that someone would have the nerve to toot their own horn, make a big deal about themselves. The surprising thing is that in this particular case, 400 other people said, "Yeah, I like him. We need to follow him." They exalt themselves. Watch out. Watch out for anybody or anything that's exalting itself. Amen. The second thing is that through signs and wonders, they lead astray after false gods. Again, just like the Bereans, we have the ability to determine right from wrong, true from false. But we've got the responsibility to do it. If you don't do it, if you're just going to believe anything that somebody says, we are accustomed mentally to receive information and then process it and then make a decision. I believe that's called deductive reasoning. We're not accustomed to someone feeding us a lie right off the bat and then feeding us the supportive information. See, because if all of the information that's given is supporting the lie, then it'll make sense to you. You'll say, "Well, everything he said supported what he be." But we're not accustomed to the first thing being said being wrong. We've got to start listening and observing the moment that someone like this opens their mouth. I love it when people don't apologize for what Jesus said. He said, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Now, for all of the gainsayers would immediately come out and say, "Well, what about the this? Or what about the that?" The response is, Jesus said, "I am the way. No man cometh." And if you're unwilling to just receive and embrace what Jesus said, then perhaps you'll go that way. They exalt themselves through signs and wonders. They lead. That's why you got a goofball like Benny Hinn that blows on people and they fall down and people say, "See?" Someone said, "Boy, he must have really bad breath." Jesus said in Matthew 24, in verse 24, he said, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect." If it were possible. Well, is it possible? Yes, but we're the ones that have to make sure that it's not possible. Here's one. Their prophecies don't come to pass. Their prophecies don't come to pass. God gave us, in the Word of God, the means by which we find out these phonies. He said in Deuteronomy 18, in verse 20 to 22, he said, "But the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die." So God thinks of him. "And if thou say in thine heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord hath not spoken?" And God said, "When a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing followeth not, nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken. But the prophet has spoken it presumptuously. Thou shalt not be afraid of him. You know, a lot of times these false prophets will declare warnings that if you don't do this, you know, if you don't give all your money, you're robbing God. He'll kill you. Jeremiah 28 and verse number 9 says, the prophet which prophesieth of peace, when the word of the prophet shall come to pass, then shall the prophet be known that the Lord hath truly sent him. In other words, if they say it and it happens, then listen to them. But if it doesn't, dismiss them. There was a Hindu seer, almost incited a riot by failing to die. The chief cleric in eastern India had predicted that his soul would leave his body sometime on the morning of November 17, 2004. And 15,000 people showed up to watch. I don't know what the true story is here. The sick 15,000 that showed up to watch. Anyway, the crowd was quiet when they sat down to meditate at 6 a.m., but turned violent when he was still alive at noon. A police baton charge was required to disperse the crowd. The seer was apologetic. He said, I wanted to leave my mortal body, but I could not. Please forgive me. I guess that's what they do. It's like the politicians of today that promise things, and then when it doesn't happen, they say, well, or the weather forecaster. They forecast some terrible storm, and then when it doesn't happen, they say, we dodged a bullet. Let me hurry on. They contradict God's word. That's why it's so important for us to know what God says. That's why it's even more important for us to latch on to a King James Bible. Because you believe it or not, the Spirit of God will ring your little bell as soon as you hear it go off a little bit. When you're so familiar with what God said, if they change one little word, you'll pick up on it immediately. Isaiah 8 and verse 20, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there's no light in them. In Romans 16 and verse 18, for they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. Tell you some more. They bear bad fruit. Just look at, it's kind of like on Facebook, you can declare yourself to be whoever you want to be. But all you have to do is see, take a look at the person's friends, and then you know who they are. Because you are right now, or very soon will be, exactly as your friends. In Matthew 7 and verse 16 to 20, we read the passage there. He said, wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. Ye shall know them. Here's a good one. Men speak well of them. When everyone is all warm and fuzzy and gushy over some individual, how wonderful he or she is. Oh, don't you just love them? I don't mind. No, I don't. No. In Luke 6 and verse 26, Jesus said, woe unto you when all men speak well of you. For so did their fathers to the false prophets. And here's the final one. Talk about angels of light here, wolves in sheep's clothing. They deny that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Any group, any organization that does not believe that Jesus Christ is very God in the flesh, dismiss it. Dismiss it. That's why you can immediately eliminate, he is God in the flesh. So your Jehovah Witnesses, your Seventh-day Adventists, you can dismiss them all. I don't care how sweet and nice they present themselves to be. They're denying that Jesus Christ is God and in the flesh. 1 John 4 and verse 1 to 3, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. Every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, even now already is in the world. Well, if it was then, it can only be increasing. Peter said this, and I'm done. 2 Peter 2 and verse number 1, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false prophets or teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Folks, we're living in the day and the age where, and I hope none of you have been taken in the financial realm through the holiday season. There are individuals probably in like a nice place like Nigeria that are sitting in a room just with a telephone and calling people and trying to interest them in this, that, or the other thing. And people are being drawn into it. Hi, I'm your grandson, and I'm in jail right now, and I need some help right away. And they said that you need to send $20,000 right now in order for me to get out. Oh no, not my little grandson. All you have to do is give. You don't have to send a check. Just give us your credit card number right now. There's people doing this stuff. Now, in the spiritual realm, there's others that would come in privily and come in and say, you ought to come with me to the church over there. Oh, it's unbelievable. They dance and prance and shout. They got a disco ball and everything. We have fun. It's a fun place. Yeah. Well, folks, there's angels of light out there. And they're looking for someone. They're looking for prime pickings. And sadly, it would probably go away if people were a little more keen on this book. We have the wherewithal in order to not be taken. Don't be led astray. Don't be led astray if something doesn't sit well. Somebody's feeding you a line. Don't do it. And if you hear something that doesn't sound right with this book, don't believe it.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent King James Bible-believing Baptist Church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and ye must be born again. Thank you for watching.